So I would say we get started. It's 2 past 10. So thanks everybody for joining this this day's webinar. And we're going to talk a bit about how Privacy Perfect built their GDPR compliance application on ArangoDB with graphs and JSON. So document store capabilities of ArangoDB. I will give a quick introduction to GDPR and the new CCPA, which is basically the GDPR for California, which is coming into effect beginning of next year. So today with me, I have Jaco de Vroot from Privacy Perfect. He will introduce himself for sure in a bit. So my name is Jan Stücke. I'm the head of communications at ArangoDB. And as data is also part of communications at ArangoDB, I had the pleasure to also work on the GDPR compliance team of ArangoDB. So worked my way through a lot of legal text and a lot of requirements that we had to fulfill. So I hope I can provide a few interesting information and overviews. But I would say, Jaco, would you like to introduce yourself a bit quickly?
Yeah, sure, no problem. Good evening it is here in the Netherlands, and good morning or afternoon wherever you are. My name is Jaco. As mentioned on the slide that Jan is showing, I'm the CTO at Privacy Perfect, which means that I'm the guy responsible for all the technical stuff that's happening in the company from architecture point of view and also the product operations side. I've been involved in there for about 2 years now, and before that I've worked in also in the legal sector, building a search engine for the legal domain in the Netherlands called Legal Intelligence. I was one of the founders there, and I'm still doing projects in that area, so that is why it also says search relevance expert on the slide of Jan. And I hope to give you some interesting insights in how we used ArangoDB in our company.
Perfect. I would say we have at least one really seasoned expert then on the call. Thank you so much for joining, Jaco. I would say let's get started. So what we will cover today is a quick introduction into the GDPR and CCPA, so the General Data Protection Regulation and the California Consumer Privacy Act. Quick overview, there's a lot of literature out there. I don't want to bore you out and put you to sleep, but give you a quick introduction what this means, where the similarities and maybe some differences lie. And then we will cover basically the two main topics from a data and developer side. So the one thing is how to build compliant applications, and the other part is building a compliant organization. And at the end, we also have some more to show. There's a quick question in the Slack. All right. I think we will cover this at the end. So the question is if the search engine is directly built with ArangoDB or something else is used for Privacy Perfect. I think Jaco will cover this in his part in just a few minutes. And of course, at the end, we have plenty of time for a bit of Q&A. So I would say let's get started. So what you see here is the global trend of different search terms on Google Trends over the past 2.5 years. So what you can see is the first, so I chose privacy, data breach, Cambridge Analytica, and GDPR. And what you can see, there was a light peak at the end of 2017 when the Equinox hack happened, and over 140 million people the data of 140 million people got stolen. Then we are all aware of the Cambridge Analytica incident and scandal. And you can see in the red line that the privacy issue or the privacy term was searched a bit more after that, mainly, I would say, also because of GDPR became an active law in May 2018, basically just 1 year ago. But what is interesting is that even after all these incidents and the first really broad data protection regulation in the EU, the term privacy was not really searched that much more. So we are currently here, as the error indicates, and it is basically the same level as it was 1.5 years or 2 years ago. So, but it is quite important. And if we take a look at the GDPR and the CCPA regulation, they have a lot in common. They define who it protects. It defines what personal information are. It is the first time that users and consumers get rights granted, like the right of deletion. It is clearly defined, or let's say with CCPA, it is more clearly defined than with GDPR, who has to comply. It is, if personal data gets collected, there's the basis of consent. And there are also financial penalties that enforce both regulations. So CCPA will get into effect on the 1st of January 2020. So for all people who are doing business with California-based users or consumers have to comply with CCPA in the States and also on an international level with GDPR, as most of you might know, it is a regulation for European citizens. So there are some similarities, but as I said, the there are also differences about who must comply. With GDPR, it is basically everyone who stores personal data. So that reaches from blue chip enterprises and organizations all the way down to the bakery around the corner or the handyman. So this is really blurry and it caused a lot of trouble and still causes a lot of trouble for companies in the EU. The CCPA regulation is a bit more fine-grained and clearly states which companies and which company sizes have to comply. So for example, in CCPA, you have to you only have to comply if you have more than 25 million in annual recurring revenue, or if you're processing more than 50,000 or the data, the private data of more than 50,000 people. So the struggle that my friends in Europe currently have with being GDPR compliant, especially in small companies, are excluded in CCPA. So they learn from the struggle in the European Union. So there are also specific rights in GDPR and CCPA that are basically very similar. So for example, the right of data portability. So you have to grant the right you have to make it possible to export data in a machine readable form. So for example, CSV might work, also Excel files, of course. So everything that is machine readable. You have the right, if you go in the center of at the bottom, the right to restrict processing. So you can say, no, I don't want to have these cookies tracking me, or I object to let my data be processed by any third party vendors. You have the right to be forgotten. That is different in GDPR compared to CCPA. In GDPR, you have a clear regulation that says if a business does not need the personal data anymore, it has to be deleted. In CCPA, at least I couldn't find such a regulation. But of course, every user has always the right of deletion. You have the right to rectification, so to correct the data that people have stored. You have the right of access, so you have to grant the right to people that they learn what data you have stored or collected about them. This also includes any kind of ranking or profiling that you're doing. And of course, and there's GDPR, very specific. Users and consumers have the right to be informed, meaning if you have a data breach, you have to inform the public within 48 hours. If you take a look at the upper right corner, rights in relation to automated decision making and profiling, this is an interesting point because this might mean that machine learning and AI are not really GDPR compliant, for example, for loan profiling. Or if a bank was a maybe a bigger bit of background, I've been to an AI conference last year in London, and there was a big European bank, one of the leading ones, who said that they are not quite sure if they are allowed to use machine learning and AI in their decision making about giving one person a loan or and the other one not. Background is that. They feel it is hard to really make an accord understand how their inner algorithms work. So this is still a bit of a bit unclear if these new technologies are allowed to be used there. And of course, if you don't have any fines or if you don't have any penalties, nothing gets enforced. So with GDPR, you have two levels. So if you, for example, didn't encrypt your data and it was stolen, or you really did anything else that really violates the GDPR regulation, you can have a fine of up to 10 million or 2% of your worldwide annual revenue, and up to 20 million or 4% of the annual recurring revenue, which is, of course, quite a serious. Now the word comes not to mind. A serious penalty. Let's put it that way. But CCPA is not really anything lower. They define it as per. They have a fine of $100 to $750 per consumer and incident. And if you think about the Equinox hack, you can do the math. $140 million. The data of 140 million people was stolen. If you do the math, then on the lower end of the penalty scale, then you see that's a serious threat for or a serious risk for larger organizations, but also small startups. Because if you look into the VC world, they might also ask you how do you comply with GDPR or CCPA next year. A really nice study that I found comes from Cisco. It's their data privacy benchmark 2019. And on the map, you can see the percentage of companies who said, yeah, we are somewhat GDPR ready or GDPR ready. You can see that in Europe, there are the majority of companies reported that they are already ready. Funny that Germany, who is really into norms and regulations, is not yet not as ready as many others are doing. But you can see if you take a look around the world, it is not there where it should be. But what I want to highlight as well is that GDPR is not only a burden or has penalties. What the study also showed that it has a lot of advantages for your organization. So companies who reported that they are GDPR compliant said that they had a lower likeliness of breaches, and if they had a breach, fewer data records were impacted. That meant shorter system downtimes, and overall the cost associated with data breaches was much lower. And of course, it is also, on a communication perspective, good if you show that you respect the data of other people. On a financial standpoint, these companies also showed that their sales cycles were much shorter because they could show we're GDPR compliant or will be CCPA compliant, so users don't have too many concerns. So, as I said in the overview file, we have two sides. On the one hand, you want to build GDPR compliant applications. On the one, and you can do this with RemedyDB. I think the most important point here is access control. You have to have a fine-grained access control to your data. So who is able to write to the database, who can see the data, which data is it that they can see. So for example, take the example of imagine a hospital. You have the doctor and you have an accountant. The doctor has to have access to the medical files, of course, but maybe not necessarily to the address and the telephone number. With the accountant, it's the direct opposite. So an accountant doesn't need to have access to medical files, but of course needs the name and the address. With RangDB, you can do this this fine-grained access control either with our Fox framework and build it yourself. If you're an enterprise customer, you can also use the LDAP integration that we have in both versions, the community and the enterprise edition. We, of course, have a basic role-based access control. Encryption is a thing that is enforced in GDPR and in CCPA. So you have to encrypt your data. This is on transit addressed, and of course backups shouldn't lie around unencrypted. With the community edition of RangDB, you have the encryption on transit. With the enterprise edition, you have the encryption at rest and encrypted backups. If anybody has concerns about the enterprise edition and purchasing licenses and all that stuff, I can reassure you that the upcoming managed service of RangDB will run the enterprise edition, and you will have full access in all tiers to the full feature set of the enterprise edition. So you can basically have two advantages at once. You don't have to take care of maintenance and deployment of your RangDB instances, and have full access to the enterprise editions if you use RangDB Oasis, the managed service. So of course you have to also have some things in place for backup and disaster recovery. With RangDB you have DC-to-DC replication. So if one data center goes up in flames, we don't hope for this, of course, but if it happens, you always have a replicated data set elsewhere. With the upcoming 3.4 version, which is currently out, you have incremental backups. Then we talked about the personal, the right to be forgotten. And with 3.5, we will release a time to live index. So you could use it to define a time or a time period in which data will be deleted. If you develop applications, you not, of course, have only your production environment, but you also have your testing and development environment. And you might want to work with data from production. And this is taken care of. Can now be GDPR or CCPA compliant with the new data masking feature of RangDB 3.5. So let's take a look at both features. So the time to live index is basically a convenience feature and can be helpful in many ways. Before 3.5, you had to run your own cleanup job and write it your own. With 3.5, you just set an index and can configure that documents are deleted after a certain time or after a certain time period. Sorry. So what is maybe more important is the data masking feature, where you can have two things. You can either obfuscate your data with and replace basically the name Jane Doe to a random string value. But in some cases, you might want to keep the structure of the information. So the enterprise edition of the data masking feature also allows you to keep the structure of the data, like seen in the credit card number or the birthday. All right. So the other side of being GDPR compliant is not only to have GDPR compliant applications themselves, but also to track where the data is traveling. So building GDPR compliant organizations. Just a quick example here from MyRangoDB. So we have data in marketing that we have to communicate, of course, to sales, then to customer success, and at some point maybe to finance when we then interact with our customers. Maybe we have another application or enterprise system that we have to integrate. So at the moment, we don't know, and I think also bigger organizations do not know which regulations will be there tomorrow or which enterprise systems they will build in. That means we have to do maybe searches for the data of unknown length, which means a graph database and the graph data structure makes a lot of sense and makes things also much easier. And we also we can't say a priori how which data we will store and which new attributes that we might enrich the data of a user with. And of course, if we go to management and regulators, they might want to have a visual representation of the data. So visualizing how data travels through your organization with a graph, and the graph visualization can be quite cool. But I think more on this, how to build GDPR and CCPA compliant organizations. This is best done by Jacko, who is an expert on that field. Again, thank you so much for joining, Jacko. And if you like, you can take over.
Okay, Jan, thanks. Let me share my screen. Now, hopefully, now you can see my slide. Yeah, so let me just give you an idea of what it is that we, Privacy Perfect, as a company, are doing. We actually didn't use RangoDB to become GDPR compliant ourselves. Of course, we have to be, but we are helping organizations to become compliant using our application that is built on top of RangoDB. One of the things that apart from all the rights to be forgotten and the security stuff that and the other stuff that Jan just mentioned that organizations have to do, they also have a registration obligation. So basically, that is what we are helping organizations with. We are doing the privacy bookkeeping, and there's a couple of things in there. The GDPR demands for organizations to keep track of how personal data is being used inside an organization. I will show you some example of that later on in a quick demo. You also have to do privacy impact assessment. So suppose some new marketing project has to happen and it needs personal data. You have to assess the privacy risk inside your organizations. And also this is where our tool is helping our customers. And also you have to the breaches, when they happen, you have to register them. So these are the things that we have been focusing on. There's tons of tools related to the GDPR out there, and we have chosen this really administrative focus. And it's quite a complicated thing to fix. Otherwise, we wouldn't be in it. People will do it themselves. We're doing this as a SaaS for our customers. The customers are in all sorts of sectors. I mentioned a few. We have really big corporates like telcos. We have also small, specialized companies that do a lot of data processing. We work in the public sector. We have got schools, hospitals. At the moment, we've got around 200 customers and counting, of course, because also we have a very busy sales team. Just to give you an idea, I will give you a quick demo. On what this is. Over here you see the dashboard. I'll just give you an explanation of what we register. This is a generic demo environment, and I will show you one of these records that we are entering in here. I will show you the processing for a salary administration. So what you see here is the basis of our register. For a processing, you need to give it the name. You can assign all sorts of categories to it, more than one if you want to do that. You can link it to other places. You can add all sorts of relations with organizations that are a certain stakeholder for the processing. For these are all legal terms. So the controller, the processor, the executing entity, and the data recipient. I will pick one here and edit. And then it's very important to register also the what you are processing. So this record says, okay, I am doing HR administration. I am doing this for these organizations, and I am storing for employees. I'm storing contact details, address, email address, phone number. This is a data source. This is where the information is actually stored, and you can add retention terms. So so this is also an important thing to keep track of for this information. You can also add attachments. You can define the legal grounds. So these are the articles from the GDPR. For instance, this I will add that this we're doing this because of the performance of a contract. And so what you see here is some part of this we have really completely filled ourselves. For instance, all this legal stuff is details that's in our databases. All the other things are little blocks of information that are actually connected to each other in this record. And this is where I will jump to the graph ID later on. Let me save this one. So what you can then do is you can have a graphical view of the thing. So over here you see all these information elements that I've just shown you in that record. And what we're also doing, and I'll explain a bit of that later on, we are keeping track of the changes. So I can compare versions, and you'll see what I've just added here, these categories. I've added this legal ground. So the auditability is an important thing for this kind of register. There's a whole lot of stuff in here that I will skip for now. You've got this dashboard that gives you an overview of what's happening in which countries. You have notifications tasks. You can define your organization. So it's a lot of bookkeeping. We're keeping track of all the data that's important for this privacy register. So this is, I think, the quickest demo I ever gave for this product, a really small part of it. What we saw when we started building this application, just a little bit of background, last year, we already had an application running, but we ran into some technical issues due to the way it was built, specifically the backend. It was done in a very complicated way. So we sat down and said, okay, what are we going to do? Are we going to fix the problems in an architecture that's actually way too complicated for our purpose, or are we going to rebuild it? And we chose the last one because we wanted to be sure to have it all under control. We have the possibility to get all our requirements done and to really build a lot of new features quickly. So what we did then was we sat down, of course, and thinking, okay, what is this data model? What is it looking? How can we model this data? And this is it's a simplified version of our data model, the abstract data model, logical data model. And over here you see that there's already a lot of interconnections. This is not what you see, the graphical view of one privacy record. This is more the general thing. So, okay, we quite quickly concluded, okay, this data model is really well supported by a graph database. So then we started looking around and say, okay, what products are there in the market? And after doing some selections and some prototyping and playing around with RangoDB, we concluded that we would give it a go and do it. We modeled this data and built an architecture on top of it. I will show you a little bit on that later. And we used a couple of interesting features of the graph ID to build our application. And I have one example here. It's access rights. So we have quite complicated access rights requirements, where a user, given his role and given his position in an organization, may or may not view one of these records. I can give you an example. You can have an organization with a hierarchical structure, and when a user has a certain role, he is not only allowed to see the privacy records of his own organization, but also everything underneath. And we modeled the organization hierarchy by using a graph model with a relation between the organization. So in this way, we were able to quite easily manage. It took some brainstorming and some fun programming to get this going, but in the end, it's a quite easy and fast way to be able to ensure that users are not allowed to they only see the stuff that they are allowed to see. The reason for this is that we have got customers that have quite big organizations, international as well, and they just do not want all departments to know about each other's work with personal data. It's all confidential stuff and sort of on a need-to-know basis. And then there's also roles like something that we call a chief privacy officer. He or she can just see everything. So there's a lot going in there. So we modeled this data, and we used the Rango query language to figure out if users access two records. So the demo I just showed you, my role is see everything, but we can play around with putting users in organizations so they only see the stuff they are supposed to be seeing. Now there's another interesting thing that we, another interesting requirement that we had was versioning. I showed you a little bit of that already, and this can get complicated in any system, I think. Being able to time travel basically through versions of your administration. This took a bit of quite a bit of let's call it an intellectual challenge to get this going. When we started doing research on this, there's a lot of documents written on this stuff, also in the more scientific world. But we started modeling ourselves, and funny thing was that a few weeks after we modeled this and we built this, there was a blog post on the RangoDB website about time traveling in graphs. I'm sure Jan knows that one, which was quite close to what we did. I'll try to explain it a little bit. So this is a piece of one privacy record, which is linked to an organization. So this is our starting position. Now, this organization is no longer in play. We are replacing it by processor number two over here. So what we're doing there is we then building a new relation hash processor to that processor and storing the old one in something prepended with an X. And this gets big, yeah. So because we've got tons of relations in the system, if we query the records that don't have an X in front of them, we always know this is the latest position, and we can always go back versions because on these edge collections there are also properties saying to which versions they apply to basically play back and to analyze differences in the data. So auditability was a very important requirement for us, and we managed to fix that by really using the power of graph and a bit of smart design and programming to get this fixed. Basically, I just showed you that each save we store a version, and we can compare these records. A bit more on the architecture side, a reasonably standard architecture. We have a single page application built on React. We built microservices based on Akka HTTP in Scala. We used the Java driver for RangoDB to connect to the database, and we have RabbitMQ for the inter-process communication. One very important thing to know, and you see it over at the bottom part, is that each customer, we call them a tenant here, gets his own database in the system. So we now have over 200 databases and moving up. So that means every time a new tenant needs to be created, we build software that provisions a new database and makes it available to the application. Now that's quite an interesting thing, because when it gets big, you have a maintenance issue. So we automated the schema management there. And although ArrangoDB is a schemaless database, you have to give the database some kind of configuration. You have to tell it which collections there are. You have to tell it which graphs there are. You have to give it information on the indexes and all that kind of stuff. So we've got procedures and software in place to manage that across all these databases, which I'm pretty sure is something that we will have to keep on developing, because at the moment there's 200 something databases. But of course, we hope our sales team gets really successful and we roll out this system, which is really a huge potential market across Europe. Then we might run into hopefully we'll run into a situation where we have many thousands of these databases. So it's not quite a typical use case. I didn't see any writing on this, specifically this database, a lot of database stuff. We also ran into challenges there, basically because of the way the clustering works with ArrangoDB. If you want to set this up across a really complete asynchronous cluster, then it gets complicated. It doesn't really work well. So we are now on the failover, the hot failover situation, which works like a charm, it's good enough for us. So of course the management of the schemas, you have to be really careful there and make sure your schema updates are in sync with your release. There's a lot of stuff that's going on there. One remark on the little database box on the right, the Swift object storage. ArrangoDB, as far as I know, and maybe that has changed in the last month, doesn't support binary objects, but we have a requirement to upload documents like PDFs and what have you. So we are using that object store for that, and then link it to the database. So digging a little bit deeper, infrastructure. Once we built everything based on microservices, as I mentioned, and we are running on Kubernetes. So we have deployed our own services on Kubernetes, but also the ArrangoDB. So there's a couple of these pods running in there, and this is quite useful. There was one question I saw on the chat, that somebody wanted to know the memory footprint of a database. We are still quite low. This is what's needed to run 200 databases, or 220, I think there are at the moment, including all the test tenants that we have there. But it will depend, because our databases are not specifically very big. Yeah, so when databases get big and you get bigger queries, that the thing will start doing more caching and it will use more memory. So I don't think there's really a simple answer to that question, other than the standard one, which is it depends. Operational stuff, we had a guy that did a lot of stuff there, and he made sure that we can get everything in dashboards and we get the logs in Kibana, so we can monitor if anything is what's going on. A lot is coming up for us. We are building a lot of stuff based on this architecture and based on this data model. A couple of things really specific to ArrangoDB we will start doing is visualizations. I already showed you one very simple one, but since all this data is interconnected, you can start building really interesting visualizations of this privacy register. You can basically browse from the privacy record to the personal data items, okay, in which systems and in which organizations are emails processed, and just browse the whole landscape interactively. We're investigating that. Already did a bit of prototyping there, and this is really where the fast access to all these relations comes in very, very well. Arrango Search is also something that we will start diving into. The search features that are in there are quite interesting for us. We've got some we can search already some part of our administration, but we will expand on that. and use the analysis features, the tokenization stuff that's now in Erango Search with these materialized views. There was another question on this, by the way, if that would match up Solr for doing auto suggestions. I would say not completely, because it will do it from the performance perspective, but I've done really quite a lot with Solr for like 10 years or so. I used it extensively, also for auto suggest. And at the moment, you are not yet capable in Erango Search to customize the analysis chain. Solr will allow you to do that, and you can basically do all sorts of magic in the term suggestions. The prefix search works, and it will be fast, even with bigger data sets, I think. Right, that should be better. I think I clicked the wrong button there. So that's the search features will be interesting, because we are getting more and more customers with bigger administrations. And this can get, you have to imagine this kind of privacy administration. If you talk to a big organization like a telco, they have got like tens of thousands of data sources, and they're managing hundreds of thousands of privacy records in them. We don't have them that big yet. We've got a couple of bigger ones. For the search features, that's going to be very interesting, because it will be the bigger administration get, the more attention needs to be given to how you can find stuff. Another thing that we are starting to work on now is a workflow, not really specific to RangoDB, but it will all be supported by it, of course. Giving people tasks and keeping track of that is going to happen. And hopefully, of course, many more databases, because we want to grow this product and get a big market. We have a sales team working on that, and marketing people working on that very hard to get this moving. And this is where we hope to use the power of our architecture, and of course of RangoDB in the future for a long time. Regarding some GDPR specifics that were just mentioned by Jan, there's some very interesting stuff coming up. This TTL stuff, this time to live is interesting. Also for us, not specifically for removing data removing personal data, but it will be interesting for automatically removing stuff like notifications. Our application generates tons of notifications, and at some point when they're not read, they're not interesting anymore. And being able to automatically remove them is really good. Also, the data masking, we will definitely start using that. It's quite difficult for us to get access to the production data, because it's all highly confident, and our customers don't really want us to play around with their data. But in some cases, it can be very useful. And if we can explain them, okay, everything that's really sensitive, we will just obfuscate, and that will really help. On the infrastructure side, at the moment we are running on the community edition, so we are not using the encryption at rest stuff. Of course, all the data is encrypted when it's going outside, and we have had our hosting operations encrypt the offsite backups. You don't need to do that with the database scripts of RangoDB. You can write unencrypted stuff somewhere and then encrypt it and remove the unencrypted stuff. So that we are our own GDPR compliance is actually quite limited, because if you saw the demo, we are not actually storing the personal data for our customers. We are storing metadata. The only personal data that we are actually storing are names and email addresses and all that kind of stuff of users. So we are, of course, very careful with that. But our GDPR specific stuff of our system itself is limited. But of course, the security requirements are really, really strict. So we paid a lot of attention to security. We did various penetration tests by external companies. All our APIs are highly secured with all kinds of tricks. So the security is very important, but that's more on our own application design than it is on the database. Yeah, well, I guess that's what I wanted to share today. I hope it was all clear, and of course, I'm wondering if you have any questions.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Jacko. Super interesting. I didn't know that you were running on I'm going to be on Kubernetes as well.
Yeah, we are. Yeah, so, that makes it was a bit getting the Kubernetes stuff up and running was quite challenging, not only for RangoDB but in general. But it's a good way of operating our system.
Yeah, it's moving so fast. You can start learning again every day, I think.
Fortunately, we found a company that is a Kubernetes expert, so we didn't have to learn it all ourselves. It's all managed. So that saved a lot of time.
Okay, cool. I think you already mentioned you already answered the question about the memory footprint. We have some other questions. So one is about how RangoDB compares to Solr. I think you already expanded on or commented on this a bit.
Yeah.
With the upcoming 3.5, we will also provide them customizable analyzers, and also do a lot on the performance side. So with improved indexes and all that stuff. But I think the question was if we also support type ahead. So please correct me if I'm wrong, Jacko. I think that relates to autocomplete features.
Yes.
Yeah. I think this is then on our roadmap for 3.6, which will be released end of this year.
Yeah.
So we got this request a lot, and we know it's needed and wanted. So this will be added soon.
Yeah. We already do a bit of that in this various search places in the system where you can search. And we just, while typing, the system comes back with the search results, and that's going quite fast. But you can at the moment not compare it with a system like Solr, which has been developed for like I think 13 years of being an fully optimized search engine with all its features. It's just a different product.
Yeah. I mean, we also don't compare ourselves against any Solr or Lucene or so. Because I mean, we just released the first version with the 3.4 of Rango Search. We will add features, of course. We have a dedicated team for that, but of course we're not there to compete with such well maintained and long developed search engines. But maybe getting there.
Yeah. Okay. So the other question is: what made you opt for RangoDB instead of other GraphDB? We are a startup, so we wanted open source, which meant Neo4j was not an option. So we didn't actually look into the functionality. We had to look at a few other open source products. I have to dig back in memory. OrientDB was one. There was one other more serious one. The multimodal aspect of RangoDB was also an interesting one. In the end, and also this requirement for this this multi-tenancy, and there's a question on that as well. That's a really interesting question, by the way. Made us in the end pick a RangoDB. Also the ease of installation and the deployment while playing around. That was the option. We didn't spend months and months trying all kinds of products because we didn't have the time. We made the choice in a couple of weeks, I think, in which we also had to do all the architecture design. So there was not a complete scientific research paper written on it, but it was a very pragmatic decision, and we knew it was. RangoDB is not the most widely known graph database. At least it was not then. Maybe it is more well known at the moment. So it was a bit of a daring choice, but after our test, we tried all sorts of performance tests. We just randomly throw in like many thousands of records, because for instance, I showed you this change log. We have got, apart from that, we also have an audit trail in which we register every save or every user. And this will become the biggest tables in our database. So we started generating like hundreds of thousands of these entries and see if the queries were still performant. And it all just looked fine. And also from a functionality perspective, we picked the most complicated requirements that we could think of, which were the versioning and the access control. And we started prototyping that and writing the queries. And once that was, we had enough confidence in that, we started doing this. Yeah. Okay, I hope that answers the questions. Then the 1 dB per tenant, yeah, well, actually, I hated it. It wasn't my preference, but it was just a business requirement. And this is really because our sales people wanted to be able to say to our customers, hey, listen, we are storing everything in your own private database. From a technical perspective, it is it's not more secure, I think, because you can build the same kind of level of security when you have one database, and that you win quite a lot with that. So it's basically moving the complexity from the application code to the infrastructure, where you have to manage all these databases. The queries are a bit more simple because you don't have to take into account the filtering out of the data per tenant. But on the other hand, we have to manage all these databases and make sure the backups of hundreds of databases are running okay and all that kind of stuff. So it's working fine, but it's also complicating stuff. But having it in all database in one database can also get complicated. Limit best practice on how to use RangoDB for multi-tenancy. Automate. If you choose to go for multiple databases, so one database per tenant, automate everything, like provisioning, database provisioning and schema management. Also make sure that that your application is compatible. Forward compatible, one release, so you are independent with your database schema and your application. If I would have to build this thing with one database for all the tenants, then probably the model would be to have sort of super nodes per tenant where all the queries start. And you have relation to all the data from that sort of super node to all the data that belongs to the tenant. So you never find anything that's coming from another tenant. Yeah. And then somebody says, enjoy your Pinarello. Yes, thank you very much. That's my bicycle over there. Yeah. So I think any other more? Oh, there was one more. Is there a good example of building an audit log? I currently use this. We have done this there's two kinds of audit log I already mentioned. One was the actual detailed audit trail of all the saves, all the changes that people are doing. And we basically built generic hooks into our application that are behind every post and put and delete request in the APIs that send some data. And we send it on, we don't save it directly from the service. We put the audit entry on a queuing system, a RabbitMQ, and we have a separate audit service that picks it up and stores it in the database, so it's asynchronous. For this versioning stuff, it's custom. I don't think there are general solutions for that. And this audit log, the trick. Now I haven't seen any triggers in RangoDB, but also, because we have an API-based system, we can do it all when the API starts. And so when there's a call to an API, we want audited. We just have one or maybe two lines of code that causes the message to be audited. And for some API calls, for instance, logins, you also want to know the result of the API call. A failed login has to be logged. A failed record save is going to the application error logs. That's not an audit thing. So that's just finding its way to Kibana and to the alerting system. Yeah.
So there was one question I just wanted to answer also directly with everybody. With the time to live in the indices, there was a question if this is only possible on collection level or also using attributes on a document level. So just checked, this is also possible on the document level. So you can just define which the the attribute and the field and the value that you want to index in the time to live index, and then configure the index that it either expires after a certain amount of time or on a certain date. So one last thing that I wanted to show you before we round up. Quick question, is there any further questions from your side? Anything that you want to ask Jacko or me? There's one further question for you, Jacko, if you're using Fox services or create custom Fox services with ArangoDB.
No, we decided not to do this. We had a lot of new stuff coming in our system, and the Fox services looked very interesting, but also we wanted to keep the things completely in control of our own application services. So we decided not to use that. And also I think there's JavaScript involved. We didn't want to start doing that on the backend. We do that on the front end, of course. So we're not using that. There's another question I see about encryption. That's one more for you, Jan. <I come.
laughs> Sure. So yes, we see that also others have already encryption at rest as their full open source offering. For example, Postgres and the well-known Postgres. We will have this, as I said, with the managed service of ArangoDB. Further plans I'm not aware of, but for everybody who uses ArangoDB Oasis, we'll have full access to all the encryption features ArangoDB Enterprise offers, so full access to all enterprise features, and also, of course, all enterprise customers. At this point, I can't say anything more if we will open source encryption at rest or not. This is also not my decision, of course. There's one more question for you, Jacko. Are you only maintaining metadata, or do you also store information about individuals? I think you answered.
It's only the metadata. So the only data about individuals that we're storing is, so the actual email addresses and names is of our own users, but for the rest it's the metadata. So what the organizations are doing with personal data, but not the personal data itself. This might change when we start looking into other supporting other legal requirements for the GDPR. This is related to what they call data subject access rights. So this is the stuff like the right to information, the right to be forgotten. So you can just basically walk up to an organization and say, give me all of my data. And we might start building stuff to support this. And then this could become a different thing, but not at the moment.
All right. I see no more questions so far. So the only thing that is left for me is say a big, big thank you for everybody who joined. And of course, thank you so much, Jacko, for sharing your usage and what you're doing with ArangoDB at Privacy Perfect. It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much. And for everybody who wants to learn a bit more about graphs and also how to deal with large data sets and complex queries, please join the webinar tomorrow, same time on Wednesday. You can find the link here. Hope you can see it. Otherwise, just join the events page of ArangoDB. It's arangodb.com/arangodb-events. And hope you enjoy your day. Thank you so much, everybody.